Good evening. You may have noticed we don't have a projector tonight. We're hoping to have one here in the next week or so. But we will make do without one and we'll worship anyhow. So if you'll stand, let's sing "This Is Amazing Grace."
Oh,
did this next song back Sunday before last called Make Room. It says, here is where I lay it down, every burden, every crown, this is my surrender. Here is where I lay it down, every lie and every doubt, this is my surrender. Be our prayer tonight. Well, here is where I lay it down, every burden, every crown, this is my surrender.
Down the wall.
Thank you. that, Lord, individually, but also as a church, Lord, that we just keep our eyes focused on you and our hearts focused on you to go and do what it is that you've commanded us to do, which is go and reach people for you. Lord, just pray that we will be a church, Lord, that reaches people for you. Lord, just take the rest of this service and have your will speak through Brother Jake, Lord, in Jesus' name.
How y'all doing tonight? I'm good. Here's what happens every Wednesday. By the time 4 o'clock rolls around, like mentally I'm like done, and then all my kids show up. I'm like, okay. A few hours later now, physically I'm like done. And then we have a few minutes of worship, and I feel recentered and re-energized and just connected with the Lord more. And so, you know, I just want to bring that up pretty much every week because I want to emphasize how important I think it is for us to prepare our heart for teaching. And I think that there is something that happens when we're all singing in unison together to the Lord. Worship is important. It's important in the life of our church. It's important to me. All that being said, we're going to be in 1 Corinthians chapter 10. 1 Corinthians chapter 10. Now, we're going to have a kind of a little mini-series because the next few weeks are going to be a little chaotic when it comes to, like, the schedule of the church. So let me just take a few minutes, I guess, to remind you what the schedule is going to be like the next few weeks. This coming Sunday, we have our graduate Sunday, and it's also Memorial Day, and we will have a special time in the service for Memorial Day. We are having church this coming Sunday night because I don't like to cancel church, and so we are having church this Sunday night. I'll be teaching. It'll be a special teaching on our honoring for our Memorial Day service. It'll be on that theme. I don't want to spoil too much, but that's what we'll be doing Sunday night. Then that next Wednesday will be the second part of this series, this special little mini-series on sin. And then that next week, you are going to hear some good preaching because we have Brother Joel Strahan coming from Sladen Baptist Church. You might have heard me mention his name before, but if you don't have any idea who that is, he's kind of like my mentor in the ministry. Taught me everything I know, some things I didn't know that I knew. Like, he's a great man of God. He was a missionary to Russia. It sounds strange to... It didn't sound as strange saying that as it did 10 years ago. Nowadays, like, yeah, he was a missionary in Russia, and it's like, can missionaries even get in Russia anymore? The answer is no, missionaries can't get in Russia anymore. But just before they kicked them all out, Joel was over there, and that's where his heart is on missions. He's a great man of God, so he'll be there that coming Sunday. And then the youth will be gone, and Lindsay and I will also be gone that week. But we will still have our Wednesday night service. We're going to have a special prayer service, and Jonathan's actually going to lead that service. And he said it's going to be good, and he's got it, and I don't need to worry or stress about it. But y'all know me. I do worry, and I stress about things. So I'm like, okay, are you sure? You sure? He's like, hey, I got it. Don't worry. So it's going to be a special prayer service the next Wednesday. Hopefully that kind of clarifies the schedule. I just want to let you know, if at all during the summer you're wondering, are we having church? Are we having church? The answer is yes. If I can help it, if it is in all within my power, we are having church. It doesn't really matter to me if there's only three people in the room. Like, I'd rather just go on and have church, right? Okay, all that being said, 1 Corinthians chapter 10. Let's read together here. And I want to start in verse 1. And we're going to read through all the way to verse 27. I don't want you to forget, dear brothers and sisters, about our ancestors in the wilderness long ago. All of them were guided by a cloud that moved ahead of them, and all of them walked through the sea on dry ground. And the cloud and the sea, all of them were baptized as followers of Moses. All of them ate the same spiritual food, and all of them drank the same spiritual water. For they drank from the spiritual rock that traveled with them, and that rock was Christ. Yet God was not pleased with most of them, and their bodies were scattered in the wilderness. These things happened as a warning to us, so that we would not crave evil things as they did, or worship idols as some of them did. As the scriptures say, the people celebrated with feasting and drinking, and they indulged in pagan revelry. And we must not engage in sexual immorality, as some of them did, causing 23,000 of them to die in one day. Nor shall we put Christ to the test, as some of them did, and then died from the snake bites. And don't grumble, as some of them did, and then were destroyed by the angel of death. These things happened to them as examples for us. They were written down to warn us who live at the end of the age. If you think you are standing strong, be careful not to fall. The temptations in your life are no different from what others experience. And God is faithful. He will not allow the temptation to become more than you can stand. When you are tempted, He will show you a way out so that you can endure. So, my dear friends, flee from the worship of idols. You are reasonable people. Decide for yourselves if what I'm saying is true. When we bless the cup of the Lord's table, aren't we sharing in the blood of Christ? And when we break bread, aren't we sharing in the body of Christ? And though we are many, we all eat from one loaf of bread, showing that we are one body. Think about the people of Israel. Weren't they united by eating the sacrifices at the altar? What am I trying to say? I'm saying that food offered to idols has some significance, or that idols are real gods? No, not at all. I'm saying that these sacrifices are offered to demons, not to God. And I don't want you to participate with demons. You cannot drink from the cup of the Lord and from the cup of demons too. You cannot eat at the Lord's table and at the table of demons too. What? Do we care to rouse the Lord's jealousy? Do you think we are stronger than He is? You say, I'm allowed to do anything, but not everything is good for you. You say, I'm allowed to do anything, but not everything is beneficial. Don't be concerned for your own good, but for the good of others. So you may eat what is sold in the marketplace without raising questions of conscience, for the earth is the Lord's and everything in it. But someone who isn't a believer asks you home for dinner, accept the invitation if you want to. Eat whatever is offered to you without raising questions of conscience. But suppose someone tells you this meat was offered to an idol. Don't eat it out of consideration for the conscience of the one who told you. It might not be a matter of conscience for you, but it is for the other person. For why should my freedom be limited by what someone else thinks? If I can thank God for the food and enjoy it, why should I be condemned for eating it? So whether you eat or drink, whatever you do, do it all for the glory of God. Don't give offense to Jews or Gentiles or the church of God. I, too, try to please everyone in everything I do. I don't just do what is best for me. I do what is best for others so that many may be saved. And you should imitate me just as I imitate Christ. May God honor the reading of His word. So, summer's always a weird time for church. The reason why it's a weird time for church is because people are traveling, there's vacations, there's camps, and it's very difficult to get like a consistent schedule. But here's what happens during the summer. We get a golden opportunity to really focus in on ourselves. We get a great opportunity to really kind of clean house within the church, to do some self-evaluation about where we are with our walk with Christ. Because here's what's going to happen come August. Immediately, for no other reason than the fact that school is starting back, we're going to see more people here Sunday morning than was during the summer. We're going to see more people here Wednesday night, more people here Sunday night. And it's not because we're doing anything different. It's simply because when school starts, we're going to have an influx of guests and visitors. And this happens at every church come August. And that is a golden opportunity for us as a church. It's a golden opportunity to reach out to these people who are going to be visiting in August. And we need to prepare for that day. And the way we prepare for that day is not to print out a bunch, get like more different pamphlets or, you know, to put a new sign on the door and to rearrange the chairs. Like, you can do all those things, but that's not what's really important. The best way to prepare for that day is to really figure out, okay, if we want the Holy Spirit to draw people to come visit our church, if we want the Holy Spirit to draw the lost to come and beckon our doors, if we want the Holy Spirit to do that, we need to make sure that our walk with God is so close, is so tight that we're following exactly what He says. That because we've proven to be faithful what God has already given us, He promises to bless us and to give us more. So during the summer, it's always a time for churches to really do some evaluation. What are some of the things that we as a church need to take care of? Think of it like spring cleaning, but it's summer cleaning in our spiritual selves. Now, there was a famous book that was written a little over 20 years ago called Respectable Sins. And since then, it has spawned a whole bunch of other books and series and commentaries. And in this book, the author lists about 10 respectable sins in our culture. 20 years ago, 10 things that he said, these are sins that occur in the church, and everyone seems to be okay with it. It's kind of the inspiration for this kind of mini-series. What we're going to do today is we're going to walk through what it means for something to be a respectable sin, how we as a culture have redefined morality. And then next week, we're going to go through, hey, here's some respectable sins, some sins that we as Christians have decided we're okay with. And the reason why we're going to hit those things is because if we can take care of those respectable sins in our lives, we would have furthered our walk with Christ, and I believe that we'll be ready to receive the Lord's blessing, receive guests and visitors and new members come August. Does that kind of make sense? I just want to give you some of the reasoning behind it. So when we look at 1 Corinthians 10, we see that Paul is warning them against idolatry. And he's bringing them all the way back to the story of Exodus. And he's reminding them, hey, what you're dealing with now as a church, it's the exact same thing the Israelites were dealing with back then. And it's the exact same thing that we are dealing with now. And the problem that is occurring is that no matter where the church is throughout history, we're always going to be surrounded by people that believe different things. We're always going to be surrounded by the temptation to worship idols. Now, idol's kind of a loaded term nowadays, so I'm going to give you a really, really basic definition. An idol is anything that you can worship other than God. An idol is anything that you can worship other than God. And the truth is, a lot of us have some idols that we worship, that we focus on, even if we don't realize that it is an idol. This is in the notes, but I'll give you one big one right off the bat. I believe wholeheartedly that here in America, we do worship medicine. And I do believe it is an idol. And the reason why is because if someone gets sick, we wait and we see what the doctor says. And if the doctor says they can't fix it, that's when we go to the Lord. But if the doctor says they can fix it, well, then we don't need Jesus. The doctor's got it. I believe that they can heal. I believe that it's in control. God's our backup plan when it comes to illness and sickness. Now, I recognize that might be an extreme example, but I do want to make a point that it didn't used to be that way, right? It used to be that we would go to the Lord in prayer first, and then if medicine and doctors could help, hey, that's a benefit, but our first trust is in the Lord. And now I just want to point out that even like with our prayer requests for the sick, it's usually, and I'm guilty of this too, it's, hey, I hope the doctor tells me the good news instead of the bad news. But I'm trusting what the doctor says, right? Pray for someone who's about to have surgery. I pray the surgeon's hands are steady, right? I want to point out, like, idols can be tricky. They can be sneaky. They can get in there. There's always a temptation to worship idols. And anytime we're falling or stumbling, anytime we're giving into the temptation of idols, we confront our own sins. And it is impossible to worship an idol without sinning in some way. So here's what Satan does. Satan always tries to redefine what sin is so that we think that certain sins are okay. Now, the big one that Paul's focusing on in 1 Corinthians 10 is he's trying to convince all these Christians, listen, you are not allowed to eat the sacrifices offered to these demons in these false churches and temples. You're not allowed to do it. You're just not. It's going to make your weaker brother stumble. I'm saying the food offered to them is the food offered to demons. It doesn't unite you. Don't do it. That's the big stumbling block. The Christians in Corinth were convinced it is okay to do some of those pagan practices, to eat the food offered to idols. They were convinced of that. In their mind, it was a respectable sin in their culture. our culture also has respectable sins, things that we don't even think about that are sins that change the way that we understand who God is. Now, for some of you older folks in the room, you're going to recognize these things right away because you're going to think to yourself, this is not how it was taught or this is not what people thought years ago. But especially for some of the younger folks, and hey, for our youth and our kids and our little babies growing up now, this is the culture that they're being taught. These are the lies that Satan is teaching them about sin. So, let's talk about how we in America have redefined morality. It's knowing right from wrong. First, let's talk about like big cultural things. What are some of the ways that here in America we've redefined what sin means, redefined what is right and wrong on that big cultural level? Well, the first thing I want to point out is that the word sin has pretty much been removed from the English language. You're only going to hear the word sin if you're in a church service. It's not spoken of. It's not said. People will look at you weird if you even say the word sin. Did you know that until the 1940s, during the presidential inauguration, they would usually have at least one mention of the word of sin. And that mention usually came in the opening prayer. The idea being that you would pray the Lord to forgive America, to forgive its people of its sins, to help you walk in righteousness. That's what happened up until about the 1940s, and then that stopped too. From 1940, if you had to dial it back and say, like, well, when was the last time a president in their inaugural address actually used the word sin? Well, you'd have to go all the way back to Lincoln before you have to find an actual use of the word sin before that. Up until Lincoln, every single president mentioned it. After Lincoln, it was only in prayers. And then from then on, never once will they use the word sin. You also don't see it in media. You don't see it in movies. Sin is only used in churches nowadays. It's largely been removed from the English language. But other words have been created in the English language. Here's a brand new word that wasn't around 50 years ago. Secular. The rise of the secular world. How many of you have heard the word secular before? What does it mean? Anyone know? What does it mean for something to be secular? Of the world? Yeah, it just means not Christian, not religious, not of God. The word secular actually comes from the word unholy. It's the exact same. It's the opposite of sacred is the word secular. Sacred means not, or secular means not sacred. That's all it means. It means not sacred, not holy. That's what the word secular means. But somehow, over the decades, we've started to divide everything into two categories. We got the religious world, and then we got the secular world. And you see, if the world is merely secular, if we don't describe the world as sinful, then it is not a sin to indulge in the secular world. I know I just said a lot, so let me kind of explain that. If I were to do a sermon, and during that sermon, I were to let out an obscenity, or to cuss during the sermon, that would be a bad thing, right? Please nod your head. Yes, that would be a bad thing. It should, huge, giant, no, should never happen. Okay, so we agree, it's bad. Shouldn't do it. Why is it worse if it's in church? If you listen to a TV show and they do it. Why is it the TV show's okay, but I better not hear it from the pulpit? Why is there a divide in our mind? Let's say that the praise band were to lead us in worship. And one of the songs they sang, you know, it just didn't sit quite right with us. There's just some words in there. It's like, I don't know if that's quite accurate. I just don't like the way it's describing God. I'm not a fan of that song. There's one thing in particular I'm thinking of. There's a famous song that came out probably over a decade ago now. And one of the lines in the song is, "When heaven meets earth like an unforeseen kiss." This is the song, "Oh, How He Loves." Now, there's a different version of that song where it says, "Where heaven meets earth like a sloppy, wet kiss." Ugh, I know, right? Just, ugh.
during the FCA rally last Wednesday night, they were practicing and rehearsing, and one of the singers sang the line, "When heaven meets earth like a sloppy wet kiss." And I was walking down that hall, and I heard it, and I said, "Okay, Lord, give me grace as I go in there and say, under no circumstances am I going to allow that." You know, I'm just like, no, that's icky. I go in, of course, and they're laughing about it because they're not going to sing that lyric, but it was a joke, and she was, you know, just trying to make everyone else laugh. They sang the correct line, "Unforeseen kiss." Now, it gave me chills, like, no, I don't like that version. We don't want that version. It wouldn't sit right. Jonathan, by the way, was the exact same way. He said, "Oh, no, if they would have tried to sing that, I would have vetoed it." That's why we went over all the lyrics with them. So we make a big deal over the music we sing in the church. But if it's on the radio, or maybe it's a song that was written a long time ago from our childhood, and maybe you haven't listened to it in a few years until you're on a road trip and you're just browsing through the stations, you hear like, "Oh, I remember this song," and then you start singing to it and you realize, "Oh, I didn't realize all the words that it said." That ever happened to any of you? Ooh, it happened a bunch to me. The prime example I have for that is not from a song, it's actually from a movie called Forrest Gump. I was not raised in what I would describe as a traditional Christian household, and I watched Forrest Gump, the VHS actual movie version, like from the age of 4. And we watched it frequently. And I watched that movie later on as an adult. And I was angry, and I was confused, and I wanted to call my mom and be like, "Why did you let me watch this thing?" We divide things into, there's the Christian world, then there's the secular world. And we came up with the word secular because we didn't want to call it the sinful world. But somewhere along the line, instead of saying, "You know what, you have songs that honor God and you have sinful songs," we changed it to, "Well, you have worship songs and then you have secular songs." And it's okay if the secular songs on the secular radio station or in the secular movies, it's okay if they have all kinds of horrible things. It's secular. We don't hold them to the same standards. We've divided into two categories. Not only have we done that, but also when it comes to evaluating nations and cultures, the evil of nations that we used to describe as the sinfulness and the evil of nations is now simply described as differences of opinion. And they say on the news, and they teach in history classes, you know, if all values are equal, biblical truth cannot be the standard upon which we evaluate morality. We look at a different country with different people, with different beliefs, and we say like, "Well, you know, they just believe different things. They have different opinions. It's okay if what they're doing is evil. That's just their values. That's just what they teach. That's just what they think." And it's just wrong.
Do y'all know what the argument was for the U.S. entering World War II? Like, what was the actual stated argument by the U.S. government to the American people? Because after Pearl Harbor, we were at war with Japan, but why did we enter war against Hitler, against Germany? Well, because some information started coming out. And until then, we refused to put troops on the ground, but then we heard about what was happening in some of these concentration camps. And once that news broke, the American people decided, you know what? We know that Germany is not going to invade America. And we don't want to risk our own troops, but we're hearing about an absolute evil happening in the world. And people signed up to join the war effort to fight that evil. And you had actual American journalists and actual spokespersons say, "Listen, this is an evil. If we're a Christian nation, shouldn't we try and defeat evil?" And everyone understood that logic. Now, you can have someone, you can have a dictator of an evil country, and you're not allowed to say that they're evil. The president of Iran died in a helicopter crash a few days ago. And they did, on all the major news networks, little clippings and told like his biography to honor him before he died. Now, this is a man who is known as the Butcher of Tehran. The reason why is because he made his career and rose to the political ranks by doing one simple thing. In Iran, he would put someone in a room and he would ask them, do you have absolute loyalty to our governmental party as we follow the Quran and the Prophet Muhammad? And if you said anything other than yes, absolutely, or if you didn't say yes, absolutely in a convincing enough way, they would kill you right then and there. And they'd throw your body in the back of the truck. And they would drive that truck to a ditch and pile you in other bodies. And then they would burn it and put it on the news for everyone to see. And over 40,000 people were killed under his leadership within 3 weeks in Iran. That's how he rose through the political ranks. Now, it seems to me like we should be able to say, hey, he died, but you know what? He was an evil and sinful man. We should not be talking about how he was a great religious and political leader of his people. I'm going to have to speed through this if I'm going to get through some of this teaching. But we say, oh no, they're not evil. It doesn't matter if they're beheading Christians. They just have different opinions, different values. In our culture also, sin is most often described as a cultural force, not as people actively choosing to disobey God. They describe it as like some impersonal cultural force. I'm going to give you three examples. First is the sin of racism. It used to be racism means you had an individual person who was racist, who is doing or saying actual racist things, and we could all look at that person and say, that's racist, don't do that, and hold that one specific person accountable. But now, that's not what racism means. Now they say, well, no, no, individual racism, a sin you can actually hold someone accountable for, has been replaced by systems, aka systematic racism, the term. Therefore, racist policies must be implemented to counter these systems. And that's what people are doing and pushing for nowadays. For instance, in many colleges nowadays, you have black-only dormitories. Because it's okay to say white people aren't allowed here. Right now in colleges, you have a lot of protests calling for the actual extermination of the Jewish people throughout the world. And they say, well, there's a system of racism that benefits the Jewish people. We can't point out any laws or any people that actually do it, but it's some secret conspiracy. Therefore, we must do actual racist things against people to counter it. So, under the guise of defeating racism, Satan has convinced people to be racist. You also have what is historically known as the chains of inequality. And this is the basic idea. And you'll hear this on the news all the time. They'll say that, hey, you know what? The real problem, the real sin is unequal outcome. The real problem is that some people have more money than other people. It doesn't matter whether that wealth was gathered honestly or not. That doesn't matter. It doesn't matter if someone's willing to work or not willing to work. That doesn't matter. The only thing that really matters is that everyone has the same amount of wealth, regardless if they're willing to work, regardless if they're good at managing it. None of that matters. Therefore, redistribution, meaning we should be allowed to take money from some people and give money to other people. It doesn't matter if they worked hard and grew that money over time. That doesn't matter. We should just take what is theirs and give it to these people. It doesn't matter if they're willing to work and they refuse to work. The real sin is that everything has to be equal. There's also something called misinformation. This might be the one that you're least familiar with. There was this idea that if there was disinformation, meaning if there was information that was wrong, then perhaps the government should step in to correct the wrong lies that's being spewed. But over the last 5 years, something else has come out. And it's under the guise known as misinformation, and there's now laws on the books that state this. And if the information is seen as dangerous, it must be silenced regardless if it is factually true. The truth does not matter. What matters is the potential effect that that truth might have. And of course, the famous example of all this is before the last presidential election, a certain news story about a certain laptop came out, and the FBI called Facebook and got them, and called Facebook and Twitter and got them to remove all the posts and to block the accounts that first posted the story about the laptop. Now, the laptop story ended up being true, but that didn't matter. The potential that it might have caused people to vote for one candidate over another was the only thing that mattered in that decision. And they said, well, it was misinformation. It was information that might be true, but it could mislead people. And so, in order to stop people from being deceived, you suppress true things and you amplify lies. This has happened big culturally. Let's narrow it down individually. These are things that I come across pretty much every week, especially when it comes to counseling. Some lies that we need to address. Here's the big lie. People do not sin. They are affected by outside conditions which force them to make mistakes. No one sins anymore. They just made a mistake. Ooh, I hear that all the time. Here's some examples. You know, spouses don't commit adultery. They just have an affair. Why do we even have that phrase? Well, it's the idea of like, well, I'm having an affair. But then later I might not have the affair. I might just put it back and then it's like I never did it in the first place. It's not a big deal. It's not you've committed the sin of adultery. It's, well, you know, they made a mistake. They slipped up. Businessmen don't steal. They commit fraud. We invented a whole word to not call people thieves and liars. People can commit fraud on their tax code, too. That's stealing. That's deceiving. But we don't want to call them that, so well, they just committed fraud. Here's a good one. We've actually completely removed the use of this sin and this word, even though it was once known as one of the seven deadly sins, from the English language. People don't commit the sin of wrath anymore. They lose their temper. Isn't that such a nice way of saying that you're committing the sin of anger and wrath? I lost my temper. No, you were committing wrath. I know, I just lose my temper sometimes. It runs in the family. What are all these things doing? They're describing the sin as something else, something outside the body. The idea being it's not a choice that individuals are making. All right. I'm going to step on my own feet here for a second because I'm guilty of this. I'm not committing the sin of not controlling my tongue. I'm just bold and I'm just blunt. Have you ever heard that before? Is that not an excuse for refusing to learn the discipline that James commands us to control our tongue? But, you know, I've used that excuse before too, haven't I? I will not be disciplined in my speech, and I'll say something that's not basked in the love of Jesus Christ. And it's not that they took it the wrong way, and it's not that they chose to be offended. And it's not that, well, I'm just blunt. I'm committing a sin. I'm not controlling my tongue. It's an example of a respectable sin, a sin that we've decided, oh, yeah, it's okay sometimes. Church member will say something to another church member. It could offend them so much that that family, that church member leaves the church. And what do we say? Well, they shouldn't have been offended. Mr. So-and-so's just blunt. Is that an okay thing? Again, I'm stepping on my own toes here, but there's 1,000 examples we could go through. We could probably step on everyone's toes if we just went through the list, right? What are some of these respectable sins that we have? Every church has a story of at least one elderly member that sleeps through the sermons.
this church is young enough, maybe y'all don't have anyone that ever used to do that. But every church I've been to before, and they used to have at least one member. It's usually a sweet old man that lived into his late 90s. And he'd usually try his best to stay awake, but he just physically couldn't. And he would fall asleep at some point during the sermon. We all have examples of that. Examples of us not doing what we're supposed to do and just thinking it's okay. I know what you're thinking. Are you saying it's a sin to fall? Here's what I'm saying. There are some people that are in such poor health, they physically cannot make it through church service. We call them shut-ins, and that is completely okay. But I've known a deacon before, not at this church, but I've known a deacon to fall asleep in the back row, and he was wearing a cowboy hat, and he leaned his head backwards, and he hit the light switch, and the lights went off in the service. And Lindsay can back me up, that actually happened. And it took us a while to figure out he was nodding off, and it was his hat as he was leaning back, hitting the light switch. Y'all need to ask Joel about that. When, by the way, when he comes to us, he'll know who I'm talking about. All these are examples of us treating sin like some outside condition that we're not responsible for. And we laugh those things off and pretend like it's not a big deal. I'm just blunt. That's not an okay thing. It's not an excuse to commit sin. Big lie number two. When people do sin, and it's so explicit, it's so graphic, that it's impossible to argue the morality of it. It's just obviously wrong. When that happens, we say, well, it's merely just a reaction to the greater sins of society. Now, I got three examples. I'm going to go through it, but I'm going to add a fourth one. Black Lives Matter riots. It's okay to riot if society's been holding you down. Hamas attacks on Israel on October 7th last year. It's okay to murder families and babies because the Israelites are colonizers. Issue of abortion. It is okay to get an abortion. Society's been keeping women down, and it's really a women's right issue, regardless if the child is alive or not. Those are the arguments being made. Here's another one. I'm just going to add this as a freebie. I can't tell you how many times I've dealt with this one. Be in a counseling session. You'll have sometimes a young man, sometimes an older man, struggling with the sin of pornography. And you know what comes out of his mouth, and what comes out of the spouse's mouth, and what comes out of sometimes their friend's mouth? Well, you know, it's just everywhere nowadays, and society's there, and I mean, it's just looking. And, heard all those things before. It's not an excuse. Here's the remedy to all these things. And we're going to go through these in detail next week, and we're going to hit some of these respectable sins in our culture. But I just want to say, here's how you can shut all those things down. First thing, apply the gospel. Here's what I mean when I say apply the gospel. Ask yourself, if you saw Jesus dying on the cross right next to you, now I mean that, like picture him right there, and apply the gospel to your life, do you think he would be okay with what you're doing? Do you think he would care about your excuse? So when I, even if it's accidentally, if I offend someone for being too blunt because I'm not controlling my tongue, do you think I could look to Jesus and be like, well, you know, I'm just blunt? You think he'd accept that? Or would he say, well, you know, I died for that person, so it's not okay you did that thing. Here's the second thing. Submit to and depend on the Holy Spirit. If you think you've fallen into one of these respectable sins, do you think the Holy Spirit was working through you, or do you think you were ignoring the Holy Spirit in that moment? And some things are very clear, especially if it comes to the things that we watch and listen to. Do you feel like you're filled with the Holy Spirit when you're singing that song on the radio? Because, you know, sometimes we sing worship songs in here, and I feel filled with the Holy Spirit. But there's some songs I guarantee I'll never be filled with the Holy Spirit if I'm singing those songs. Recognize your responsibility. It doesn't matter what anyone else ever did to you. It doesn't matter what trauma you have gone through. It doesn't matter what someone said. It doesn't matter your conditions. It doesn't matter if you had a late night. It doesn't matter if you haven't had your coffee yet. It doesn't matter what your personality type is. I don't care about any of that. Because Paul says in 1 Corinthians chapter 10, God will not give you a temptation that you cannot overcome. He will always provide a way to escape. We all have personal responsibility when we sin. There's no such thing as I couldn't help it. Identify specific respectable sins. Like, name the actual sin. Figure out what is it in your life that you're struggling with. Big one for me is being blunt, but you know what? There's a lot more I could list too. Lindsay's like, absolutely, you could list a lot more. Memorize and apply appropriate scripture. Now, for memorize and apply appropriate scripture, I'm going to describe this a little bit. I'm not just talking about memorizing individual verses. I'm talking about knowing passages and whole stories of scripture. Because when Paul is talking about resisting these idols, he's reminding them of the whole story of Exodus. And he has some specific accounts, like when they did give in to pagan immorality, sexual immorality at the altar, and we can go into more detail from it, but here's a Bible quiz for you. Who here remembers the false prophet that God spoke to through a donkey? Now, is that the main thing he did over the course of his life? No. Because later on, he does lead the Israelites into sexual immorality, and God strikes down 23,000 of them. And that happens in the book of Numbers. That's his specific thing, but Paul's recalling the entire story of Scripture, saying, hey, remember that story when you're dealing with these idols. Don't give in to idols like happened before. Memorize and apply appropriate Scripture. Cultivate the practice of prayer. If you know what this respectable sin is in your life, you know what you're struggling with, if you ask God to help you with it every day, it's going to keep it on your mind. You're going to be submitting the Holy Spirit with it. It's going to do a lot more than anything I can say up here. And lastly, involve the church in your sanctification. Now, this is a big one that we don't usually do nowadays, but I'm trying to live by example here. The reason why I kept going back to me being blunt is so, from now on, if I ever say anything and it is much too blunt, you know what you're supposed to do as my church family? You need to call me out on it. You need to hold me accountable to it, because it's not okay. Don't say, well, he's just like that. I'm okay with you having a little mercy on me, but I'm just saying, like, no, I want the church to be involved in my sanctification. I want all of us to be involved in each other's sanctification. If you need help becoming a stronger Christian, involving your church family is one of the best ways to do it, because they're the ones that are going to be able to hold you accountable to those things. They're the ones that are going to be able to see and experience it. They're the ones that are going to be able to pray for you over it. It's a mistake not to involve your church family in your process of sanctification. You see throughout Scripture over and over, Christians helping one another follow Jesus more closely. As a group, as a community. Don't miss out the fact that as Paul's describing this, he speaks about them being united together as one body. And the example he uses is when they take the Lord's Supper together, being united and bound to each other. So, really easy steps. We are completely out of time. So, part two, where we're going to actually list out what are some of these respectable sins. Some of them you might be able to guess. Some of them are complete surprises. But they're all things that our culture has said, it's okay if Christians sin in this way, even though the Bible has made clear it is not okay for us to sin in this way. So if you want to know what those respectable sins are, tune in next week. Remember, next Wednesday, we're not meeting at 7 o'clock. We're meeting at 6:30 because we do not have a meal next Wednesday night. So be here at 6:30. Either eat before or plan to eat after because there will be no food. Unless you want to bring food, I'm okay. If you want to bring me food, I will eat a burger as I'm doing this, you know. I'm trying to get a joke. Y'all are like, I got like three of you like, yeah, this is really good. And then everyone else like, how do you find out? All right. Tell you what, I'm actually going to ask Brooks to close out in prayer.